Hello, my friend. Welcome to your sleep story. My name is Stephen Dalton. I'm an Irish storyteller, and it's my great privilege to be the voice that you listen to as you go to sleep tonight. In tonight's sleep story, you will revisit the antique store known as Nathaniel's. If you haven't been before, don't worry. Every story is unique. Nathaniel will welcome you, and you will browse around his beautiful antique store late at night, enjoying all of the amazing artifacts. And there is something very special about this store. It offers a door to other times. So who knows which time in history you will visit tonight. I hope you like the story, and please tell me in the comments other places that you would like to visit in history. Okay, let's do the relaxation session now, which will take a few minutes before tonight's sleep story. I'm going to count down from 10 to 1, and as I do, allow yourself to let go more and more. 10. Feel the support beneath you, whether it be your bed or the floor or the earth beneath all of it. Allow that awareness of the earth supporting you to enable you to let go a little bit more now. Wherever you might be holding, just soften. The earth is always here to support us. 9. You are safe. My voice will only ever take you to safe places. Allow my voice to be an anchor of safety tonight. A friend to allow you to unwind and to enter a dream world. 8. Feel into your body now. Really notice where you are still holding tonight. Maybe it's in your feet. Maybe your hands. Maybe in your belly. Maybe your face. Just release now. You don't need to hold on anymore today. It's time to let go. Seven. Know that peace lives within you. Always. Peace is a part of you. It is just waiting to be seen, to be felt, See if you can feel that peace now. That peace that you deserve. Where do you see it? Where in your body? In your head? Maybe your chest? 6. Allow yourself to feel a little gratitude now. For this moment. For this opportunity of rest. To be able to listen to my voice. Bring you to a peaceful place. Five. The day is done. Whatever has been, has been. Whatever will be, will be. Whatever thoughts are entering your mind, perhaps about the day that was, or what is to come, they do not serve you now. But they are not to be repelled or fought with. See them for what they are. Just thoughts. And allow them to float away. Like clouds. In a starry night sky. Or leaves. On a moonlit river. 4. You deserve rest. You deserve sleep. We all do. Allow that fact, the knowledge of that fact, to bring you more into this moment. To know that you deserve this moment. Three. Begin to engage with your imagination now. Begin to see a beautiful little village in a land far, far away from all that you know. And begin to see the little antique store now. How cozy it looks on this night with the candles lit inside. 2. Tune into your body one more time now, releasing any more tension. 1. Completely letting go now. As I tell you tonight's sleep story. So, tonight you will visit once again the little antique store known as Nathaniel's. If you haven't been to Nathaniel's before, allow me to tell you a little about this amazing antique store. Nathaniel's store is in a little village, far, far away from all that you know. In fact, I don't think I mentioned this the last time we visited Nathaniel's, but Nathaniel's store is, in fact, in the same little village as the Sleepy Bookstore. Now, not many people know how to find Nathaniel's, but just so you know, it is third on the right, after the plant store. Also, not many people get to visit the antique store, because, well, not many people can find it. But now that you know where it is, allow your imagination to bring you to the outside of the store. It's nighttime, and the village sleeps, and the store looks beautiful. But it also looks closed. But don't worry, Nathaniel has been told of your arrival and has kept the antique store especially open for you. He only does this for special visitors. And because you are special, you get a nighttime visit to Nathaniel's. Now, Nathaniel has run this store for many, many years, like his father before him, and his father before him, and his father before him. And now, Nathaniel stands before you and welcomes you into the store. He is a tall, slim, elderly man with twinkling, knowing, bright blue eyes, and old but smart clothing. He wears an old bow tie, a worn checked shirt, and baggy trousers. And over it all, he wears an apron, an old brown apron. "Welcome, my friend," he says to you. "Have you been here before?" "Very good. Well, feel free to have a browse and stay as long as you like. I have all night," he says to you. "There is something magical about my store at nighttime. It's almost like the antiques come to life. I really hope you enjoy looking through the place. If you have questions, just ask. Oh, and I'll get you a cup of lavender tea. You feel welcome and safe here, and perhaps a little bit excited to enjoy this wondrous place. You begin to look around. The store is a treasure trove of history. Each piece with its own story. The wooden floorboards creak softly under your feet. A comforting sound that speaks of the countless souls who have wandered through this space before you. The air is filled with so many wonderful smells. Old paper, polished wood, and a hint of lavender all around you. Shelves and display cases are carefully arranged with an assortment of artifacts, and in the candlelight they look almost otherworldly. Certainly very beautiful. There are clocks that have ticked away the hours of centuries. Delicate porcelain figurines, their painted expressions frozen in a moment of silent conversation. Leather-bound books whose pages hold the thoughts and dreams of authors long past. Nearby, a collection of vintage lamps and chandeliers, though unlit, catch the candlelight and reflect it back in a subdued sparkle. Where have these artifacts been before? Where have they lived? What have they witnessed? Have these lights hung in grand houses of the 1700s? Have these pocket watches been worn by gentlemen of early 19th century London? Have these grandfather clocks adorned the great houses of Paris or Austria or Romania in the early part of the 19th century? What about these fountain pens? Have they been used to pen a love letter written in a garden all the way back in the 1910s. Maybe a lovesick young woman has written to her husband fighting in the Great War, using this very pen. These artifacts are more than just artifacts. They are tools. No, they are more than tools. They are friends. They are friends of humanity. They are creations of humanity. They are, in a way, extensions of our inner worlds. They come from the ideas of great people and are manifested here in front of you. They have lasted because they are quality, because they are made with care, because time has been taken, love has been put in to each one of these artifacts, these antiques. These antiques that have been here long before you or I, and will probably remain after we are gone. The warmth of the light, the richness of the air, and the quiet beauty of the objects around you combine to create a sense of stepping through a portal into another time, a place where the magic of the past is kept alive in the gentle glow of candlelight. There is a reason why it is known to be special to visit Nathaniel's at night. It is because you find a connection to these objects much deeper than in the day. Now, an object catches your eye. A vintage compass, resting within a polished wooden box, lined with velvet. The compass itself, with its aged brass casing, speaks of many voyages, and the hands that once relied upon it for direction across unknown seas and lands. The compass's face is a marvel of craftsmanship. Its delicate needle poised, as if ready to guide the next traveler. Around the dial, the cardinal points are engraved with exceptional care. As you lift the compass from its resting place, the needle swings gently before settling, aligning itself with the magnetic pull of the earth. Holding the compass, perhaps you feel a connection to it not just to the places it has been, but to the stories it holds. The weight of it in your hand is a tangible link to the past, to the adventurers and wanderers who once looked to it for guidance under starlit skies. Nathaniel, observing your interest, approaches with a smile that holds a depth of understanding. He hands you your lavender tea. "That compass," he begins, "has seen more of the world than most. It's a bearer of tales from distant lands. A witness to the courage and curiosity that drive us as humans to explore." His eyes, bright and knowing, reflect the flicker of the candles, emphasizing the importance of this artifact. Nathaniel leaves you in peace, and as you continue to look at the compass, something a little out of the ordinary happens. You feel the need to close your eyes, and as you do, the compass in your grasp gently warms. The environment around you dissolves into a cascade of colors and sensations, and when clarity returns, you're no longer in Nathaniel's antique store. You find yourself aboard a tall ship. The sturdy wooden deck beneath your feet. The vast open sea surrounding you. Under an expansive sky, you feel completely safe and completely welcome here. You've arrived in the age of discovery, an era when the world was ripe with new frontiers and the promise of unseen lands. This is a time of great mystery, when much of the world was still undiscovered, when people would sit in one part of the world and could only imagine what it was like in another part of the world. There was no fast access to information, and it took months to travel any significant distance. The air is filled with the salty tang of the ocean, mingling with the aroma of tar used to seal the ship's planks. Above, the sails billow with a robust wind. The crew around you is a flurry of activity. Each member, clad in the attire of the time, loose shirts and trousers, weathered by the sun and sea, and tricorn hats, shielding their eyes from the glare above. Their language, a mixture of old dialects, fills the air, a fascinating blend of commands, banter, and the occasional sea shanty. Observing these people of the past, perhaps you're struck by how they look just like you or me. Put them in some modern clothes, and they could just as easily live in our time. Their faces are a little more weather-beaten, perhaps, than you or I. But they look determined and are alive with the spirit of adventure. Each face telling a story of sacrifice and relentless pursuit of the unknown. The captain, with his astute gaze and steady hands, consults the very compass you brought with you, navigating not just the ship, but the fate of all aboard, towards new discoveries. As the day goes on, you watch the crew go about their duties, hoisting sails, manning the helm, and scanning the horizon for signs of land. The rhythm of life here is dictated by the sun, the wind, and the sea. Standing on deck, perhaps you notice the sheer magnitude of the ocean's expanse, a humbling reminder of the vastness of the world and the courage it took to explore it. Breathe in this moment, feeling safe. Enjoy this moment, far away from all that you know. You have no worries here, no commitments. This is your time. The captain notices your interest in the compass and in the ship. He invites you to his quarters. You are his guest. His cabin is the biggest on the ship. It is quite a fine room, meticulously organized, and beautifully decorated, with detailed carvings of wood. There is a fine window at the end that looks out onto the ocean. And the room is filled with maps scattered across a large oak table. And the walls are adorned with navigational tools that have guided him through many voyages. It is darker in here, and so the glow from a small lantern casts a warm light, making the cabin feel inviting in the midst of the vast open sea. He begins to speak, his voice carrying the weight of years spent navigating the unknown. The sea, he says, is both our greatest challenge and our most profound teacher. It teaches us about our limits, about our potential, and about the inexhaustible capacity of the human spirit for curiosity and exploration. Dressed in a coat that has weathered many storms, this man's eyes reflect a deep understanding of the world. Every journey is a leap into the unknown, he continues. But us humans, we have a desire to see beyond the next wave, beyond the horizon. We are driven by the belief that there is always something more to discover, something beyond the edge of the map. The language he speaks is in fact an old form of English, but somehow you understand him. His words resonate deeply, transcending time. The world is vast, and the more we explore, the more we realize how much remains unseen, unknown. It is this endless pursuit of knowledge, this unquenchable thirst for understanding, that defines us, that unites us across ages and cultures. He gestures to the maps and tools around him. These are not just instruments of navigation. They are symbols of our journey as humans. our explorations are not just about discovering new lands, but about uncovering new possibilities within ourselves, about stretching the boundaries of what we believe is possible. Perhaps as you listen to the captain speak of human endeavor and curiosity, you're struck by the timeless nature of human exploration. It's not just about the physical journey across the seas, or indeed, in our time, across space, but the journey within, the exploration of our own depths and capabilities. In his quarters, surrounded by the tools of navigation and the maps of the world, perhaps you feel a deep connection to these explorers of the past. The captain, with a thoughtful pause, now suggests, before the day ends, you should venture back to the deck. There's a beautiful sunset approaching that promises to be unlike any you've ever witnessed. He stands and leads you to the door of his quarters. His movements, sure and steady. A lifetime at sea, evident in his gait. The end of the day, he muses, is a time for reflection, for appreciating the journey thus far and anticipating the adventures that lie ahead. The sunset, with its myriad colors, is a daily reminder of the world's beauty and the cycle of life and exploration that continues with each passing day. As you step out onto the deck, the air feels cooler. But the scent and the feeling of calm is palpable. The crew seems to have slowed their pace, some standing along the rails, their faces turned towards the horizon, anticipating the evening spectacle. The vast ocean, previously a deep blue, now begins to catch the early hints of the setting sun's palette, orange and pink touching the waves. The horizon is clear, save for a few distant clouds that promise to catch the sunset's colors and amplify its beauty. You sit down, as do most of the sailors, and as if in some sort of church, a beautiful silence descends upon the crew. As the sun begins its descent, the sky transforms. A live performance of light and shadow. The colors deepen, spreading across the sky, reflecting on the water, turning the sea into a mirror of the heavens above. Sitting on the deck of the ship, surrounded by the silence of the crew and the vastness of the ocean, you are witnessing a moment of great peace and beauty, shared with explorers of the past, humans that are long gone now, but made a strong contribution to the discoveries of our world. It's a scene that connects you across time to all those who have stood watch over the sea. Perhaps the captain's words echo in your mind, a reminder to cherish these moments of wonder. As the last traces of the sunset fade into twilight and the sky dons its starry cloak, the sailors gather around, eager to share one of the sea's oldest arts with you, navigating by the stars. The deck becomes a classroom, the heavens their chalkboard, as these seasoned mariners point towards the celestial bodies that have guided their paths across the open waters for centuries. One of the sailors, a man with eyes as keen as an eagle's, begins to explain. See there, he points towards the North Star, Polaris, a constant in the night sky. She's our faithful guide, always fixed, always true. When you find Polaris, you find north, and from there, You can chart your course anywhere. The crew's admiration for the stars is palpable. Their knowledge, passed down through generations of sailors who relied on these glittering points of light long before the compass or GPS. The constellations, another sailor adds, pointing to a group of stars shaped like a hunter. They tell stories, but they also tell us where we are. Orion there, he's most visible during our winter voyages, a beacon for sailors. As the lesson unfolds, you're introduced to the concept of navigating by the stars. It's about understanding the sky's map, a young sailor chimes in. His enthusiasm for the tradition evident. The stars are more than just light. They're tools, markers that help us traverse the vast sea. Now lying on the deck, completely relaxed, you gaze up at the Milky Way, its band of light, a river of stars flowing across the sky. Breathe in this moment. Enjoy the simplicity of this moment. Really allowing yourself to relax now. The sailors share tales of their nights at sea, of storms weathered, and calm water sailed, all under the watchful eyes of the stars. And after this mesmerizing experience, you start to feel sleepy. So one of the sailors, a kind-hearted soul, with years of the sea etched into his face, gestures for you to follow him. He leads you through the ship's narrow passageways, and finally you arrive at a door. He opens it to reveal your private room for the night. It's a modest space, yet there's a certain charm to it that makes it immediately welcoming. The room is lit by a small lantern that casts a soft, golden glow, creating an atmosphere of warmth and coziness. that contrasts with the vast open sea outside. The centerpiece of the room is a single bed, its frame made of the same sturdy wood that makes up the ship. The mattress looks inviting, covered in clean, simple linens that promise a comfortable rest. Beside the bed, a small porthole offers a view of the night sky, allowing you to gaze at the stars from the warmth of your room. A small desk stands against the wall, with a quill, ink, and parchment set neatly atop it. A space where countless sailors have likely penned letters home or recorded their thoughts under the silent watch of the stars. Perhaps this is a moment for you to write your thoughts. Or perhaps you are very sleepy and it's time for bed. The sailor wishes you a good night, and with a nod and a smile, leaves you to the quiet of your room. As you prepare for bed, the gentle rocking of the ship and the distant sound of the waves against the hull lull you into a state of peaceful readiness for sleep. Here, in this small room, on the vast ocean, you find yourself enveloped in the timeless rhythm of sea life, ready to drift into dreams filled with stars, waves, and the spirit of adventure. And it all started with a compass in Nathaniel's antique store in a little village far, far away.